sense and getting the most out of very bright people. So those are the things that you learn only by experience. Now teaching is also evolving to the next level where they bring in experiential learning. So I would encourage you to view theory and take courses and interact with your faculty so that you start getting a taste of it right now. But finally, when you do it, every day is new learning, and one should be open to sort of that possibility of learning something new. It doesn't end with theory. Please feel free, Shailendra bhai, to pitch in if you have.
Sir, hope is the leverage that we use for the initiation and continuum of a business. So, sir, as you said that as you are the head of the advanced material division of your company, what makes you think that the products which do not have a market or use in the current time will be successful in the future? I mean, that's a bet against uncertainty.
Yes, but I think all new things are a bet against uncertainty, and you make those bets in as informed way that you can. So that process of which bets to select, that is not a hope, that is a science. So you have to, for example, in the advanced materials division, we scan the entire globe for success stories. I mean, there have been, when GDP per capita crosses a certain point, certain types of products and services become important in any country. For example, US and Europe and US were the first to go through that transition. They lost their traditional textile industries, and now today there are lots of textile manufacturers in US and Europe, but they're all technical textile manufacturers. Because their transport, environmental, human safety, market needs grew. Then came Japan, did the same thing. Then South Korea has done the same thing. Now China is in the middle of that transformation. The next, it's very likely that it will be us. That said, you can't simply copy North America or Europe or Japan. We're India, we're different, we're Indians. Our social and political scenario is different from those countries. So you take that general concept that these products and services will also be necessary in India, but then you try and bring, tweaks and changes to those offerings based on the Indian context. So a lot of market research goes into these decisions. We meet hundreds of potential customers. We start with very low risk. We do pre-marketing using, at negative margins, using, existing products from other countries to see how the acceptance is in India. So, it's not just a hope that, I think this will be successful and tomorrow I invest 50 crores of rupees in putting a plant for that. There's a lot of effort that goes into it. Took me 2 years to start Arvind Oji Nonwovens Private Limited. We found a Japanese partner, found a very, very good technology for air pollution control fabrics. Took one whole year to do a market survey on whether or not the Indian market is ready for this product. Spent another year in project managing the right technology, hiring the right people, building the right kind of contacts with potential buyers. And then we started after 2 years, and in a matter of 6 months, we are generating free cash flow. So it's a very involved process. It's not just a prayer and we start.
Sir, good evening, sir. My question is to Shalini, sir. So many startups do fail. So how do you know that your idea is the big idea? When do you know that you have to do it now?
Sir, you know, you, at one level, you never can tell. I think the clear metric, I think as Puneet Bhai also pointed out, is that what is the value that you're creating for the target market that you have. If you have a clear understanding, if you can clearly articulate it, if you can clearly communicate it, I think you're ahead of the game. But at the end of the day, you have to assume that until it is market tested, you know, in the venture community business, it's called when the dogs eat the dog food, right? You can create the best dog food, but if it's created for humans, unfortunately, if it tastes good to you, it's not going to do dogs any good. So therefore, you have to be very clear about whom you are targeting and what is the value proposition that you're communicating. And then I go back, I will go back to the earlier example that I used, that of the chapati or the paratha. Don't ever treat your first venture as your last. Don't ever fall in love with your venture. You can be passionate about it, but remember, a venture, entrepreneurship is not like a marriage. It's not like an Indian marriage, you know, whether you've married for life. Ek baar ho gaya, uske baad mein dobara nahi karenge. You know, that mentality is great for a marriage, but it is disastrous for an entrepreneurial venture. You must be passionate, you must give it the time that it requires, but not more time than it requires. Fast failure is extremely important. And in the venture business, there's another saying, you know, apart from dogs, you know, in my course, over the course of the lectures, there are about 18 or 19 such mantras, but let me share another one for you, which is, in America, they say, the lemons ripen faster than the pearls. Now, lemon is slang for things that don't work. In America, if you get a bad, you know, if your car that you get, the new car that you get fails, then you say it's a lemon. You know, it's a defective product. In other words, a defective product. They say lemons ripen faster than the pearls, that you know that a venture is bad far earlier than you know that the venture is good. At that point, you have to be very clear that you're not in love with that venture. Because if the venture is bad, you have to ruthlessly cut it off. And I think that is how a conglomerate manages that process, which, by the way, the good venture capitalists in the world, the bad venture capitalists have still not figured it out. But the very good ones know exactly how to manage the portfolio of new opportunities that are coming out, which are the ones that you should feed with fertilizer and water, and which ones you should ruthlessly prune. I think that is the key.
One thing I'd also like to add, and it's my father, Sanjay Lalbhai, started 18 ventures that failed before Denim was successful. So, you know, and many of them were good ideas. So a good idea with a good value proposition is not guaranteed success. That's just one more thing that I'd like.
Right, which is precisely why, and you know, that's a wonderful statistic. And I was reading a similar story about G.V.K. Rao, the people who build airports and so on. The business that finally succeeded was his 19th business. You know, he gave an interview to Shekhar Gupta where he listed all of those. You know, he tried pipes, he tried irrigation business, he tried everything. And ultimately, he figured out a winning model. So part of the learning is fail fast and fail as painlessly as you can. And the most important thing that you will take away from a failed venture is experience. Remember, experience comes from making mistakes. And again, I will not touch upon this, but just briefly allude to it. And this came out in a seminar that we had done next door some time back, where they said, Do not, it's okay to lose money. Don't lose a relationship. And this is something that Gujarat understands far better than others. And in fact, one of the entrepreneurs who presented some about a month ago, you were there at that conference, Puneet Bhai, he said, and he said, put it beautifully, and I said, you know, wow, this is a good Gujarati, expressing a Gujarati ethos. He said, it is not a partnership for profit, but it is friendship for life. So if you basically partner with people with that motive, that it's not a transactional thing, ki yaar thoda sa fayda leke, you know, apne raste chale, then you will come up with something different. And I would imagine that the team that you have at Arvind has stayed with you through thick and thin, and you know, they've figured out, and you know, you've tolerated them through failure because they're learning. You know, you sort of come up with these things together. So similarly, if you partner with somebody, make sure you grow together.
There was a question in the back.
Sir, there was a time when your leverage was too high and you were not able to survive in, like, you were not able to survive in the market. So what were the factors that hold you, that you would be able to survive further and you would be able to cope up with the situation?
So, I mean, the fundamentals were there. I mean, the moves that we did, they were going to create value. India needed those kind of fabrics. You know, all the, you know, all the macros or the fundamentals were good. It was the risk and the way we did it that landed us into trouble. So, you know, one always had faith in the business. And we didn't know. I mean, how did we know? We didn't. We were living with uncertainty. There was a very good chance that we wouldn't make it. So, but because we believed in the idea, we kept persevering, and I think there was divine intervention to make sure that we came through, because it was a really tough period. So, yeah, to answer your question, we didn't know that we would come through. This gentleman in second row.
Good evening, sir. My question is to Salendra, sir. Sir, in any developing nation, encouraging financial capitalism will provide more opportunities to young entrepreneurs or encouraging production capitalism?
Can you say a little bit more about what you mean by the two?
When I'm talking about financial capitalism, I'm focusing on what most of the developed nations think on or do, like FPI. If we talk about financial capitalism, the idea is to conquer the economy by providing more funds or grants in a nation. And when I talk about production capitalism, the idea is to provide long-term assets, to grow more long-term assets in any nations, which India is particularly thinking on right now by, you know, providing 51% of FDI in railways and etc. So the production capitalism more focuses on long-term assets. So what will provide more opportunities to young entrepreneurs when it comes to any developing nation? What nation should go for? Right. That was my question.
Okay. I'll answer a slight variant of your question, and tell me if it doesn't satisfy you, then I can try one more time. In my course on entrepreneurship, I have a framework which I call the Six Uncertainties framework that I've developed. It is a mistake to think that money is the biggest uncertainty. See, young people, when they start out, they say, "Yaar, paisa kahan se aayega?" You know, where will the money come from? And I say, that is your third most important uncertainty. The most important thing that you have to figure out is, where are you adding value? It is not, don't think about where the money will come from, just ask, how will you satisfy your target audience? Itna khush kar do usko ki wo bole, yaar bhai wah maza aa gaya, iske bina to main jo bhi aap de rahe hain unko ki, you know, this is just perfect. Then they become your word of mouth, whether it is B2B or B2C, it does not matter. And then essentially, if you go to any investor with that record of satisfying real problems of real clients, the money will come in gushes, you know, it will gush towards you. Matlab, jholi bhar ke aayega, bori bhar ke aayega aapke paas. So that is the key. And so therefore, you as entrepreneurs should not worry about where the money will come from. Just figure out how to create the best solution for the market or for your customers. I don't know, does that answer your question?
Sir, it's the question to both of you. Sir, by using crutches like market research, we are only trying to increase the probability of making the right decision. But sir, there are times, for example, George Michel, who headed Michel Energy for 6 decades, there was scientific proof that the oil fields which he had ordered to drill for 3 decades and never came about were a not good decision for him to go. Yet he persisted for 3 decades. But for the last decade that he lived, he ended up dying a billionaire 3 times. So the gut feeling, he went on with this gut feeling that let me do that, but the scientific data did not approve of it. So how important is that gut feeling in real life business situations?
Okay.
See, I would urge you to take a look at one of the most significant books that have been written in the last decade. It's by a Nobel laureate by the name of Daniel Kahneman. It's called Thinking Fast and Thinking Slow. Has anybody read that book? Has anybody seen that? Daniel Kahneman? 1 or 2? Okay. I'd strongly urge you to look at that. There he makes a distinction between system 1 and system 2. All of us are basically 3 different brains that are grafted onto each other. We have a reptilian brain, we have a mammalian brain, and then we have a human brain. One is the size of a pea, the other is the size of a lemon, and the third is the size of an orange or a coconut. And they're all one inside the other. And these are 3 different senses, types of processing. The first one is just fight or flight. That is what reptiles are very good at. That is not very good for decision making in any sense. Then there is a mammalian brain where you very quickly assess the situation and come up with an answer that you can't verbalize. That is what is called system one. Most of our decisions are actually non-verbal, non-rational. They are system one decisions. System two is a circuit breaker. Matlab, jo current system 1 mein ja raha hai, wo galat jagah ja raha hai, and system 2 just is an override function. Logic, for most of us, is just an override that comes in when we want to negate something that we are otherwise going in the direction of. That is the crux of that book. Now, the reason is very interesting. The processing power that the system one brings to bear is just massive. Think of it as follows. Sometimes you forget a name, right? By the way, once you get older, it happens more. Now, the interesting thing is that when you forget a name, there are literally millions of names that you have encountered, and you get stuck. But then you just instruct your subconscious, or you just become aware of the fact that you need to remember that name, and the next morning when you wake up, you will remember it. What has happened is that your system one, which is also called subconscious mind, has actually processed a lot of information in the background in batch mode, and sets it up and gives it to your conscious mind. This is detailed in a lot of in Daniel Kahneman's book. That is on the subject. Having said that, most people do not trust their system one, partly because sometimes it makes mistakes. But most of the time, it is far faster and far more reliable than your system two. Example is my wife. I am a very system two kind of person. As a professor, you can't be anything other than that, right? Many of my colleagues here will consider myself an economist. You know, I studied with some very good economists. And so when I was making investment decisions, I would go through this analysis, investments, mind you. Say, this is the perfect company to invest in, and my wife would say, come on. And I'd say, no, this is the analysis I've gone through, and 90% of the time she would be right and I would be wrong. It infuriates me. She has the best system one of any person that I'm aware of. She will meet a person and say, ye theek nahi hai. Ab 10 saal baad mein mujhe pata chalega, after having dealt with that person umpteen times, because she is very, very intuitive. And you know what? Living with her for 24 years, I have become a much better system one person. I have learned to let go of my system two and not come up with rational solutions that go against the... But again, it's a matter of training yourself. And that is where I've given you a long answer to your question, but unfortunately I don't know how to make it shorter, partly because this whole process is still a mysterious process, but it is fundamental. If you're an entrepreneur and you have to make quick decisions, you have to learn how to use your system one to your advantage. I'm developing some thoughts. As you know, I've become better at it. I'm observing my wife, let's put it this way. I'm observing my wife and I'm understanding how she makes decisions, and I'm trying to then put that into a process. And I can tell you, I'm becoming much better at it. So the moral of the story is, observe all the women in your life and see how they do it.
I think you need both processes. You need both. You need system one, system two. And sometimes system two to justify to people like shareholders, board members, that your system one is okay. So
by the way, please don't get me wrong, system two is important as well. As a professor, I cannot say otherwise. You'll put me out of business if I say system two is not important.